Dr. Paulie Gavoni.
And I'm Anika Costa.
In our last video, we discussed applied behavior analysis. Now, applied behavior analysis, or ABA, is probably the most well-known area of behavior analysis, and it involves using behavioral principles and procedures to change and improve socially significant behavior.
ABA seeks to help people make a positive difference in their lives using safe, respectful, sensitive, and kind approaches. But ABA is rooted in the experimental analysis of behavior, or EAB for short. So what the heck is EAB?
Well, the earliest work associated with EAB was conducted by B.F. Skinner while he was working on his doctorate at Harvard University in the 1930s. Skinner's approach to the study of behavior was greatly influenced by research in experimental medicine, especially neurology and physiology, as well as physics.
And even though Skinner obtained his degrees from the Department of Psychology, his work was radically different from the usual work being done by psychologists even way back. Rather than focus on mental states as a cause of behavior, Skinner and other psychologists using EAB studied the relationship between behavior and observable changes in the environment.
Sure did. Skinner's earliest work used rats as subjects. They were placed in a small chamber where conditions like lights, sounds, and access to food were carefully controlled. He varied several things like how hungry the rats were, how many times the lever had to be pressed for each small bit of food, stopping the delivery of the food when the rat pressed the lever, turning lights on and off, and pairing lighting conditions with whether lever pressing resulted in food being provided.
Skinner carefully varied several things, usually one at a time, to see what effect each had on the rats pressing the lever, essentially what resulted in lever pressing happening more or less often. In the 1940s, Skinner and his students also began studying operant conditioning with pigeons.
Yep. They discovered that even though pigeons pecked small plastic discs instead of pressing levers like rats, the same effects on rat behavior that resulted from reinforcers and punishers were also found with pigeons. In addition, the different types of lights and sounds used with pigeons were applied to rats and also had the same result. More complicated rules and relationships between behavior and reinforcement were studied as well.
As more complex situations were studied, systematic relationships were found between behavior and what was being studied. Researchers found a powerful impact on behavior as a result of a variety of factors, such as how often reinforcement occurred, how much reinforcement was given each time it was provided, and how quickly reinforcement was given after a behavior occurred, and how much effort was required to be made for a behavior to be reinforced.
Ways were developed to determine how well rats, pigeons, and other species distinguish between different stimuli, such as how bright a light was, the color of the light, the loudness and frequency of sounds, the size and shape of objects, and whether stimuli were treated as the same or different from each other. As a result of this research, Skinner developed the procedures that we now know as operant conditioning.
Operant conditioning occurs when a consistent relationship exists between a particular behavior and a consequence for that behavior. For example, when the rats pressed small levers, the consequences produced were small amounts of food being delivered to them under certain conditions, like around mealtime. The rats' lever pressing behavior was more likely to increase when the rats were hungry, and the food pellets made available after the lever pressing was what Skinner called a reinforcer.
Very important concept. A reinforcer is something that is available after a behavior occurs and increases how often the behavior occurs again in the future. When reinforcement or something preferred is made available after behavior occurs, it is called positive reinforcement. Positive referring to the addition of something that results from the behavior.
And since we're talking about positive reinforcement, we must also learn about another type of reinforcement called negative reinforcement. Now, negative reinforcement may not be what you think. In the case of behavior analysis, negative actually refers to the subtraction of something from the environment. Let's break it down. What happens when you get in your car and you turn on the ignition?
Well, if your car is like most, a few seconds after you push on the accelerator, there is likely this annoying little warning signal that's initiated if you haven't done a certain little something. Mm-hmm. What's that something your car is signaling you to do? Put on your seatbelt. Now, most of us don't want to drive around with that obnoxious sound. I know I sure the heck don't want to. Yeah. So that signal was initially designed to increase what?
You guessed it. Seatbelt wearing behavior, as putting it on removes that annoying signal. This is an example of negative reinforcement. The effects of behavior resulting in the removal or avoidance of something that we would usually say is unpleasant or aversive. In this case, it's that annoying signal.
I like getting rid of that. Negative reinforcement occurs when a behavior is followed immediately by the removal of something you don't like, or what we might call in the field an aversive stimulus. This removal of that stimulus increases the likelihood the behavior will happen more often in the future. Much of what we do as humans is a result of our history of consequences for our behavior. The behavior is strengthened or weakened over time.
Mm-hmm. This is how learning and ultimately behavior happens, because the organism, as in the example of the rat we discussed earlier, is trying to get something, which is the food. Or, as in the seatbelt example, you're trying to get away from something, that annoying signal. Whether we realize it or not, almost all of our behavior occurs because of the consequences produced. Just like in other sciences, such as medicine, Skinner kept things simple.
Simple is good. Over time, and as more studies were conducted, researchers began applying more complicated rules for when and how reinforcers would be given following behavior. New research looked at the effect of potentially aversive or unpleasant consequences or outcomes that followed a behavior. When certain consequences were applied, they resulted in the behavior happening less often. Such things were called punishers.
And just like reinforcement, there are two types of punishment: positive punishment and negative punishment. Now, positive punishment occurs when an aversive or unpleasant stimulus is present when a certain behavior happens, and it decreases the likelihood that behavior will occur again in the future. For instance, let's say you were late for work and your boss catches you as you're running to the door. He stops you and reprimands you for being late in front of your coworkers. That was really embarrassing and super aversive to you. But guess what? It was an effective punisher if you are never late to work again. The punisher, or positive punisher, in this case, was the reprimand, as it was something added by the boss.
Yep, that's right. I don't like it when they add that.
Either.
Negative punishment works a little bit differently. It occurs when something that is really reinforcing is removed. Take the example of the teenager who comes home an hour late past their curfew. Man, I hate that. The consequence? The parents immediately take away the teen's car keys and state that the teen is now grounded for a week and cannot go out because of the curfew violation. The parents know that going out for the teen is reinforcing, and by removing or subtracting the teen's ability to go out, the negative punishment will likely decrease the teen's coming home late behavior in the future.
Mm-hmm. But let's get back to the history of EAB. By the late 1940s, after teaching and researching at the University of Minnesota and Indiana University, Skinner returned to Harvard to research the effects of spaceflight on behavior.
Pretty cool, huh?
That's so cool. Beginning in the 1950s, operant conditioning procedures were used to study the behavior of rats, monkeys, and chimpanzees on various tasks during space flights, comparing it with their behavior while on the ground. Much was learned from this research that led to safe and successful human space flight.
That's so cool.
So cool.
By now, the principles of behavior were being studied by Skinner and others like his colleague and close friend Fred Keller at Columbia University. And operant behavior had been found to hold true for many different species, including horses, cows, chickens, dogs, monkeys, chimpanzees, and of course, humans. progressively more and more complicated types of behaviors and combinations of behavior were and are studied and found to change systematically as events are varied in the environment.
Mm-hmm. The number of researchers doing basic behavior analysis research and the number of universities where these researchers work have continued to grow. In the late 1950s, those researchers had some difficulty getting their research published in traditional psychology journals. So they started their own professional publication, the Journal of the Experimental Analysis of Behavior. The first issue of this journal was published in 1958, and since then has continued to be the premier professional publication for the experimental analysis of behavior. Since the start of the Journal of the Experimental Analysis of Behavior, new journals publishing the same kind of work have begun, and some of the old ones now publish basic behavior science research work as well.
Yep, that's right. And research in the experimental analysis of behavior continues today. When B.F. Skinner died in 1990, many new researchers had joined the field by then, and EAB research continued uninterrupted. Actually, the research has expanded since 1990. The universities providing training and conducting research in the basic science of behavior continue to grow worldwide.
More and more, right? And new and ever more complicated types of behavior are now being studied, like behavioral economics or the study of economic decision making. That's like tied to shopping, you know. I like that. The result of that research is consistently being used in real world situations to address important personal and social needs. That work is called applied behavior analysis.